by you getting that, I will pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this wonderful privilege to assemble together in your name. For it is in your name that we do assemble. You said in your word that wherever two or three will gather together in your name, that you would be in the midst. There's more than two or three of us here, so we know that you're already here. And we're asking you to give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. The eyes of our understanding being enlightened that we may know what is the hope of your calling. Give us receptive hearts and listening ears. We bind any way the enemy may try to block our thoughts, visions, or revelations to hinder the word of God or the free flow of in Jesus' name. Devil, we come against you as a unified body, reminding you that you are bound. You have no place in us, neither will we give you any, for we have been redeemed by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And we're now in the kingdom, and every member in the kingdom have authority and power over you. So we exercise that power in commanding you to leave these premises now. Thank you, Lord, for the ministering angels that are here with us. They move up and down the aisles, ministering to each and every person at their point of need and helping me to articulate this word in a way that is clear and concise so that faith may arise in the hearts of the believers. And everyone in agreement says, amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Tonight, Good Friday. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I couldn't wait. Ever since last year, I got this message. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The crushing. Oh, I tell you what, you're going to enjoy it. Your spirit man is going to enjoy it, but your flesh might be saying, I don't know about that. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. Over in Matthew chapter 26, beginning with the 36th verse, it says, then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane. Keep that in mind there, Gethsemane. And said unto his disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. And then said he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further. Glory to God. I mean, I think that's some of our problem right there. We don't go further enough. Jesus, even when he was under pressure, went a little further. We can get that. You get under pressure, learn how to go a little further. Okay, that's not the message. Let's move on. And fell on his face and prayed, saying, O Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto his disciples and findeth them asleep. And said unto them, and said unto Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then coming he unto his disciples and said unto them, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then drop back to Matthew 21, just one verse of scripture, verse 44. And it says, whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken. Or you can say it like this, whosoever fall on this stone shall be crushed. But on whomsoever it shall fall, it will grind him to powder. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Glory to God. And go down and turn over to John chapter 1. And we're going to read that later, but go down and go over and turn to John chapter 1. You know, around this time of the year, I like to reflect back on Gethsemane, the cross in the tomb. And you all have probably heard me minister that message that God gave me years ago. Gethsemane, the cross in the tomb. I never forget that one day. Those words just kept going around in my spirit, in my inbox, I like to say. Gethsemane, the cross in the tomb. Gethsemane, the cross in the tomb. I'm going like, Gethsemane, cross in the tomb? And I finally picked up on it. And I said, Lord, what are you trying to tell me about Gethsemane, the cross in the tomb? Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then he unfolded that revelation to me about him in his life. How many believe that Jesus was our pattern? He was our pattern. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Actually, from the time of Jesus' baptism up until his death, burial, and resurrection, you can actually follow your own journey. Thank you, Lord Jesus, because his life in ministry parallels our life in Christ. It should parallel our life in Christ. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Remember when, you know, he came to the baptism of John, and John said, "Behold the Lamb of God." Thank you, Lord Jesus. And as John baptized him, coming up out of the water, the Spirit of God spoke out and said, "This is my beloved Son of whom I'm well pleased." Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, you know, when you give your life to Christ, the Spirit of God takes you and immerses you into the body of Christ. He becomes John the Baptist. He takes you and immerses you in the body of Christ. And then God says the same thing of you that he said of Jesus. "This is my beloved son or daughter in whom I'm well pleased." And I like to bring that out just a little bit, because a lot of times, you know, when we look at ourselves and we look at our own human frailties and our shortcomings and defaults and character defects, we seem to think, well, God can't be pleased with me. No, that nothing is further from the truth. Yes, God is not only, listen to this, God is not only pleased with you, he's well pleased with you. Now that outer man, he may have a problem, but with you, he's well pleased with you. Say, "This is my beloved son or daughter in whom I'm well pleased." You know, I like to use that illustration. You know, we've all had children, especially in the toddler age and when they were young and so forth and so on like this. And we were well pleased with them. I mean, we didn't want to trade them off for somebody else. You know, just send them back to the factory. They're not right. They don't do things right. They don't do what I say. They won't clean up the room and so forth and so on. No, you do not think that, you know, "Lord, I wish I had another child." No, you are well pleased. Anybody often you couldn't agree with that? If you ever had children before, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You are well pleased with your child. No matter how much they drive you up a wall and no matter how many character defects they have, you are still well pleased with them. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, God is well pleased with you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But in coming up out of that water and being baptized into the Holy Ghost, it seems like we always go through a wilderness of temptation. I mean, I don't know about you, but after I gave my life to Christ, man, I tell you what, the temptations start coming out of the woodwork. Old girlfriends that I hadn't seen in a while. I mean, you know, friends that wouldn't give me the time of day, want me to go out and get high with them, go to the club with them and so forth and so on. No, man, I don't do that anymore. Oh, man, come on. Now, wait a minute. When I wasn't saved, you wouldn't give me the time of day, you know. But now you want to give me a free high and you want me to go out and you're going to pay the way and so forth and so on. I mean, you know, yeah, I kind of went through a wilderness of temptation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But after I survived that wilderness of temptation, just like Jesus, I returned in the power of the Spirit. God started using me in supernatural ways. I mean, the gifts of the Spirit start flowing through me, so forth and so on. And yes, I got persecuted from church to church. Especially coming up in the Baptist church. You know, we don't speak in tongues. We don't do that stuff around here. You know, we don't lay hands and prophesy around here. So yeah, we got persecuted from church to church. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But all of that was in transit to the cross, on our way to the cross. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But before we get to the cross, we got to come to this little place called Gethsemane. This little place called Gethsemane. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And I often say, if you don't have a good Gethsemane experience, you'll never be able to endure the cross. Each and every last one of us, we talk about a cross. You know, they sing the song, "Must Jesus cross, bear the cross alone and all the world go free?" And we talk about the cross that we have to bear. But what about the cross that bears us up? Yes, there is a cross that we have to bear, but then also there's a cross that would bear us up, that would bear us up. Thank you, Lord Jesus, just like it did Jesus. And if you don't have a good Gethsemane experience, you will never endure the cross. But what I want to focus in on is Gethsemane. What I want to focus in on is Gethsemane. Because the Hebrew word for Gethsemane, not the Hebrew word, but the Greek word for Gethsemane actually means oil press. Oil press. Oh, and from there, we're going to go a little bit deeper. You ready for this? Glory to God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The word Gethsemane simply means oil press. An oil press is used to crush olives to get the oil out of them. Oil is also symbolic of the Holy Spirit and the anointing. How many already knew that? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Under the Old Testament, God gave them specific instructions on how to make the anointing oil, which was used to consecrate priests, prophets, and kings to serve in their office. The oil poured upon them signified the Holy Spirit coming upon them. Now, God did gave them very specific instructions on how to make the anointing oil, and then told them, no one from here and forever should ever make the anointing oil like this again. Gave them specific instructions and ingredients on how to make that anointing oil. Why? Because it was symbolic of the Holy Spirit. And told them, if anybody's ever caught trying to make this oil or reproduce this oil, you know, they're cursed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Or actually, you know, they was under the penalty of death. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So there was a specific purpose and reason for creating and making the anointing oil the way it was, because it was symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, let's look over there in John. You there? Thank you, Lord Jesus. See, in Gethsemane, and talking about Gethsemane being, because you stop and think about that, Gethsemane being the oil press. Gethsemane being the oil press. And I say that you and I, we have to go to Gethsemane. We have to have a good Gethsemane experience. Because you see in Gethsemane, the pressure of Jesus' situation coming upon him actually crushing him. That pressure actually crushing him. And the Bible says his sweat was as great drops of blood. You can actually see that oil oozing out of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Why did Jesus have to go to the oil press? There was something on the inside of Jesus that had to come out. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But in order for it to come out, he had to be crushed. Come on, say with me. In order for it to come out, he had to be crushed. There was something precious on the inside of him. And the only way to get it out is that he had to be crushed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, you know where I'm going with that, don't you? Because it's the only way to get it out of you. Okay, let's read over in St. John chapter 1. It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Now, verse 4 is what I want you to see here. In him was life. In him was life, and that life was the light of man. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In order for us to live, Jesus had to be crushed. In him was life. See, the life of God, the Greek word for it is zoe. The life of God was on the inside of Jesus, but in order for us to get that life, he had to be crushed for us. Each and every last one of us, he had to be crushed for us to get that life out of him. Thank you, Lord Jesus. After he was risen from the dead on the day of Pentecost, notice this, the oil of life was poured upon 120 in the upper room, and it haven't stopped pouring yet. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Jesus was crushed, and after the day of Pentecost, that oil, thank you, Lord Jesus, began to be poured out in the earth. And it shall come to pass, said God, in the last days I will pour out of my spirit. The only reason why he was able to pour out of his spirit was because Jesus was crushed. And we reap the benefits of it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So, Mr. and Mrs. Believer, if Jesus had to be crushed, what about you and I? What about you and I? See, that the oil of life has been applied to our life. Or let me say it like this. The oil of life has been poured into you now. The same oil of life that was in him has been poured into you now. But that oil of life that's been poured on inside of you won't do you any good. Just shut up inside of you. Yeah, you have the oil of life in you. Jesus said, out of your belly shall flow what? Rivers of living water. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It's on the inside of you, but it won't do any good. All shut up on the inside of you. God needs it to come out of you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. To touch and bring life to everything around you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. To touch and bring life even to your physical body. to touch and bring life to your circumstances and situation. God needs that oil to get out of you. That is the main problem with us. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Every last one of us, we are powerhouses. Everywhere we go, there's enough power on the inside of us to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out devils, to unstop deaf ears. It's on the inside of us. But the only reason why we don't see it in our circumstances, situations, the only reason why we don't see it in the community is because it's shut up on the inside of us. There need to be a crushing. There need to be a crushing. And that's the problem. Doppelganger. That ganger hopper don't want to be crushed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And until we go through a crushing, until we go through a crushing, that power will actually benefit no one. You'll take it to heaven with you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And that's not God's intention. So if you wonder why, may get a little bit ahead of myself. If you wonder why we are going through some of the things we're going through, it's called the crushing. It's called the crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, let me go on. Are you with me so far? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, of course, you know I'm going to give you the definition to this word crush, don't you? Oh, gosh. Are you ready for this? Crush, by definition. To press or squeeze something so hard. Oh, gosh. Somebody said, Pastor, I don't even like the sound of that already. To crush or squeeze something so hard that it breaks or loses its shape. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, like the Russian said in Rocky, I must break you. There has to be a breaking thing. He said, I think one time he said, I must crush you. If he didn't, I just said it. Okay. Crush, by definition. Listen to this. To break something into powder or very small pieces by pressing, pounding, and grinding. By pressing, pounding, and grinding. Does it seem like anybody often here is being pressed, pounded, and ground up? Yeah, Pastor, I'm in right now. That pretty much describes my situation. It's like I'm being pressed. It's like I'm being constant crush. By definition, listen to this. I like this. Crush, by definition. To defeat a person or group that opposes you by using a lot of force. Now see, that one right there should have run home with you. Crush, by definition, to defeat a person. Crush, by definition, to defeat a person. Okay, y'all missing it. Crush, by definition, to defeat a person. Remember the teaching that we gave you all on the process of becoming? The process of becoming? Yes, we've been born again, and we've given our lives to Christ. And Scripture says, to as many as received him, to them gave him power, listen to this, to become. Oh, that gets bows. To them gave he power to become the sons of God. Go look the word become up. You know what the word become means? To begin to be. To begin to be. So basically we're saying, to as many as received him, to them gave he power to begin to be sons of God. To begin to be sons of God. Because until you go through a crushing, or until you go through the process, you're not any more than a servant. Remember what Paul the Apostle said? He said, you know, even though we were children, yet as a child we're not any better than a servant until we have actually grown up. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No, we haven't become yet. Yeah, we have the potential to heal the sick. We have the potential to cast out devil because of the oil. We have the potential to raise the dead. We have the potential to shake nations. Come on, somebody. We have all of this potential on the inside of us, but we haven't begun to be yet because we haven't been crushed. Now, the process that we must go through, it's a series of actions and operations that will crush us. But nobody wants to be crushed. We all like our little comfort zone. I don't know about you, but Mr. and Mrs. Believer, I want to be all that God says. So you have the potential. You have the potential. Thank you, Lord Jesus. When you was born on this earth, if you had all of your mental and physical faculties, if they was all there and you know, there was no, what am I trying to say, defects or whatever like that, you know, you had the potential to be anything you want to be. Don't look at the doctor and raise your nose up at him. You had the potential to be a doctor. You had the potential to be a rocket scientist. You had the potential to be a business executive. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But unless you go through a process, you never will be. Same way when it comes to us and God. We have the potential to be everything the Word of God says we are because of what's in us. Stay with me now. We have the potential to be everything. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You don't have to suffer all of this hardship and all of this deficiency when it comes to finances and power and all this. You don't have to suffer any of that because you have the answer on the inside of you. The problem is we just simply need to be crushed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Because this outer man right here, because and that's going to be my next point. When you say crush, Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm talking about this outer man, the doppelganger. You know, we taught you on the doppelganger, the double walker, the double goer. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It is him that's hindering. Remember something the Lord told us when he gave us that message? He said, the reason why come my people can't walk in their authority and dominion is because of the doppelganger. The double goer, the double walker, you are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in this physical body, or you live in this doppelganger. If your spirit was to step outside of your body, it looks exactly like your body. It is anatomical. We talked about that. It has eyes, it has legs, it has hands, it has a mouth, it has a nose, it has the same internal organs. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It is your double, it is your doppelganger. And your physical body, thank you, Lord Jesus, is a major hindrance. And that body, the will of that body, has to be crushed. Now, I'm not talking about from a physical standpoint. I'm talking about from an emotional standpoint, from a mental standpoint. You are in doing the teaching on the doppelganger, we talked about the two wheels. Remember that? The two wheels. The will of your spirit, which is you, and the will of your flesh. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Paul said, what is it? Every time I go to do good, evil is always present, because when I try to do the good stuff, I wind up doing not doing it. And the bad stuff that I don't want to do, I wind up doing it. See, it's because of this right here. The will of the flesh is very strong. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It is not my will to go out here and live a life of sin. don't talk to the flesh about that. The Bible says, you know, the flesh is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So when we talk about a crushing, we're actually talking about crushing the will of the natural man. And until that, the will of the natural man, Lord Jesus, until the will of the natural man, come on, devil, stop it in Jesus' name. Until the will of the natural man is crushed, thank you, Lord Jesus, that the oil of life is going to stay shut up on the inside of you. Oh, isn't this something to be right smack dab in a situation, and all the power you need to get you out of it immediately is on the inside of you? Oh, you see, it is not God's intentions, and get this, it is not God's intentions or will, you know, to really give you a hard time while you're down here. You know what, Lord, over and turn around, why do you just want to crush us, Pastor? Why do he want to crush us? It's not his will, but it has to be, because this flesh that we're dealing with still has an Adamic nature. The Bible says, and it is enmity against God. It is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And until we go through a crushing, we're going to just miss out on the power of God, or the oil of life that's on the inside of us. Oh, y'all still with me? Jesus, come on. Glory to God. So crushed, by definition, to defeat a person or group that opposes you by using a lot of force. By using a lot of force. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Like for instance, you know, me and my wife, you know, we ordered a lot of pecans from down south, and we done ate them up already. I mean, we ordered a whole bunch of pecans. You know, but inside the pecan, if you want to get to the goody, you got to do a crushing. And some of them you had to put a lot of pressure on to crush them. You know, and I was walking around teasing my wife and telling her, listen here, if you want to get to the yolk, you got to break the egg. Just period and point blank. If you want to get to the yolk, you got to break the egg. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And sometimes it takes a lot of just depending on who you are, what you're going through, what you're dealing with, what you came out of, what you were addicted to. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Some of you crushing may take a lot of pressure. Some of the crushing may take a lot of trials, may take a lot of tribulations, may take a lot of going through just to break you, just to crush. It may take a lot of force. Yeah, I mean, you know, just keep on running around out there thinking you're big and bad enough to do whatever you want to do. Thank you, Lord Jesus. That's okay. You know, God's going to let the pressure get greater and greater and greater and greater. See, some of us, we have the call of God shut up on the inside of us. We have a nation-shaking anointing. We have a devil-casting out an anointing. We have an evangelistic anointing shut up on a prophetic anointing, an apostolic anointing that can set people and nations free shut up on the inside of us. And God has got to allow a lot of pressure to come and crush us, because that outer man has his own mindset, has his own agenda. You know, we talk about people running from God. The person that's born again themselves, they're not running. It's that outer man. Don't want to submit to the will of God and allow that oil to come out of them. Ah, glory to God. I don't know about you, but I'm getting blessed. Hallelujah. Last definition right here, crushing. To alter or destroy structure. To alter or destroy structure. Bob, you know a little bit something about that. If you turn down a house, you crush that house to alter it or to destroy it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Sometimes you have to destroy it. Sometimes you have to alter it. But a crushing has to take place. Thank you, Lord. I like this one right here. Crushing, to subdue completely. To subdue completely. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you've been in the Lord any length of time at all, you should know that before you go to a new realm in God, listen to this, there would always be a crushing. Don't fight the process. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, I'm going through, Pastor. Pastor, you don't understand. I'm going through hell, Pastor, hell. That's okay. That's okay. That's okay. You're going to be all right. You're just being crushed. Pastor, you don't understand. Affliction after another. One affliction after another. If not that, it's my husband. If not that, it's the cat. If not that, it's the dog. If not that, I got fired. That's okay. You're going to be fine. You're just being crushed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. See, and I see this all the time with believers. I see that great call on you. Like, for instance, are you off in here? I see that anointing and that call on you. I see that oil, in other words, in you. But that outer man, when I discern, I see it, that's the furthest thing. I'm like, Lord. Because sometimes I want to tell you, do you know you're called to do this? Do you know you're called to do that? And I know the first thing you're going to do, no, Pastor, you got the wrong person. No, I'm not talking to that person. Let me talk to the inner man for a while. Yeah, most of the time, people, they ducking and shying away from what they're really called to, and it's not them, it's that outer man that's saying, no, I don't want nothing to do with that. I remember when God started trying to deal with me about pastoring. I said, I bind that in Jesus' name. I'm an evangelist. I'm called to travel the world. I'm called, you know, no, sir. And I, the thing about it is, I work close with my pastor, so I saw the hell that members put a pastor through, and I didn't want nothing to do with it. Yeah. Members, pastor? Yeah, members. See, what you all don't realize is when the last word of God is preached, and the last amen is preached, and the benediction is given, and you guys walk out the door, and the lights go out, then those members from hell come out. You have no idea. Oh, my goodness. By the time I got home, I got an email. By the time I got home, you know, I got a text. Come on, somebody. By the time I got home, somebody was knocking on the door. By the time I got home, I got a phone call. Now, of course, this is not what you all hear, but thank you, Lord. Just thank God we don't have some members of hell in here. But I'm telling you, I've seen that, and I've experienced that. And I told the Lord, no. But yet there had to be a crushing. Each and every time you get ready to go into a new realm with God, there has to be a crushing. In other words, the will of that outer man, of that doppelganger, has to be crushed, because, you know, the first thing you want to do is draw back from it. Think the outer man is like, oh, Lord, I heard about it. I don't want a ministry. Don't give me a ministry. Nope, there's going to have to be a crushing. You've got to get to the point. See, we see it even in the life of Jesus. Jesus, here in the Garden of Gethsemane, he's been pressed, or he's been crushed. And then you see in our Lord and Savior, for a moment there, he was drawing back. He said, Father, you have all things are possible with you. Remove this cup. And then he thought about it. He said, no, wait a minute. But thy will be done. Not my will, but thy will be done. I'm telling you. You may not like what God is calling you to. Your inner man does, but your outer man, no. There has to be a crushing. Okay, let's move on. Stop it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. One of the reasons why people don't grow or is not elevated to a higher level in God is because they shy away from the crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Before we can truly be used of God in the way he truly looks like this, wants to use us, we must go to the oil press, or we must go through a crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You see, God wants to use all of you. You getting this, Facebook? God wants to use all of you much greater than what he's using you now. But he can't until you go through the crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You get that? Jesus was mightily used of God during his earthly ministry, but there was a greater call and work yet to be done. A call and work that were literally called the physical crushing of his body. Now, again, we see Jesus. He healed the sick. He raised the dead. He cast out devils. I mean, he fed multitudes. He walked on the sea. He did great works. But listen to this. There was yet a greater work. All of that was good. And God said, yeah, that's great. But I need you to go a step further. He went a little further. I need you to go a step further because there was a greater call. God was thinking about the world. He wasn't just thinking about them back then. He was thinking about the world. He wasn't just thinking about them back then. He was thinking about you. He was thinking about me. There was a greater call. Thank God that Jesus allowed himself to be crushed. In him was life. And that life was the light of man. Thank God that he allowed himself to be crushed. Will you allow yourself to be crushed? Stop running from the process of the crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. He's just trying to get that oil out of you. And until we go through these, okay, let me go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. What is your oil press? Actually, what is crushing you? What is your oil press? Or what's crushing you? Do you feel any pressure now in your life? Financial pressure. Pressure in your body as far as physical ailments. Pressure on the job. Pressure with the IRS. Glory to God. coming, that date is getting closer and closer, you know. pressure. Are you feeling any pressure? What's crushing you, or what is your oil press? Is it persecution? Because sometimes, you know, that is. I mean, you know, we're going through all kinds of persecution. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Is it physical attacks against your body? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes, believe it or not, that can be part of the crushing. That can be part of the crushing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I remember, when I was believing God for two toothaches. And I said, man, bless God, I'm going to stand on the word of God. What are you talking about? Crushing? But after I got crushed, that oil started oozing out of me, and it completely healed me, completely delivered me. I cannot tell you how many times, you know, I've had physical ailments come against my body. And I said, that's okay. Go on, devil. Press as hard as you want, because sooner or later that oil is going to come out. I'm preaching a lot better than y'all saying amen. What is your oil press, or what's crushing you? How about financial hardship? How about loss? How about loss? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Every time you turn around, you're losing something. Something has been taken away. And it's adding more and more pressure, more and more pressure, more and more pressure. Thank you, Lord Jesus. How about, and some people listen to this, how about mental depression? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Some people, you know, they sit there and their mind is under attack constantly. No, Jesus said, whosoever fall on this rock shall be broken, but whosoever the rock falls upon will grind him to powder. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I'm telling you, Mr. and Mrs. Believer, a lot of us, this flesh hasn't been broken yet. And so, remember one of the definitions? Great force. The more you struggle and the more you try to get away, the more pressure is going to be applied, because God is going to get that oil out of you one way or another. And except he get it out of you, you're no good for nothing. You know, we're talking about ascending, going higher. But in order for you to go higher, you got to be crushed. In order to ascend, you got to be crushed. And then there are some people that ain't got to the point to where they just decide they are not going to be crushed. They're the ones that's tossed on God's spiritual junk heap. They're no longer usable. Because they didn't got to the point to where, you know, that even crushing them won't do any good. They just decided they will work against the process of being crushed. And so now they fall on God's spiritual junk heap. They're no longer usable. Why come? Because God can't get the oil out of them. Can't get the oil out of them. I don't know about you, but I want to be used of God. I want God to get every drop of this oil out of me. I understand what I'm saying. There's a process of crushing can y'all follow me? You see where I'm going with this? Thank you, Lord Jesus. We must go through the crushing, because the only way to get that yoke-breaking, burden-moving power out of us is by the crushing. It's not really God's will for you to go through a crushing process, but your doppelganger, your double walker, your double goer is in the way, and the only way to get that yoke-breaking and burden-removing power out of us, we have to be put under pressure. The oil press is all about putting you under pressure. Listen to this. Don't draw back. I know you can see even where Jesus almost drew back. But he went alone and yielded himself to the crushing process. The natural tendency, especially for the outer man, is to draw back from the pressure. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I don't know about you, but my will and desire for God to use me is so great. Crush me, Lord. Crush me. I will go through it. I mean, if I had to go through pain, if I had to go through rejection, if I had to go through friends turning on me, turning their backs on me, if I had to go through family members turning against me, I mean, crush me, Lord. See, actually, that's what you're doing. Even when you're fasting, you're trying to crush. See, fasting, you're trying to crush yourself. Okay, let's close. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So let's talk about how can we endure the process, the crushing process. Because, yeah, Pastor, I'm like you. I don't want to draw back. I don't want to. How can I endure the crushing process? Or do you really want to know? Anybody up in here really want to know? Do you want to know, Facebook? How can I endure the crushing process? Number one, thank you, Lord Jesus. Number one, trust God. Trust that God, even in the midst of you being crushed, trust that there's a greater purpose. There's a greater purpose. Sometimes I'm here to tell you, there are crushing processes that I went through that I did not understand at the time. But I look back on now and see that if I hadn't went through that crushing process, I wouldn't have this anointing, or I wouldn't have that anointing, or I wouldn't be where I am right now. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If I hadn't went through that, I can look back and see that it was that crushing process that brought that out of me. Can anybody, have you been there yet? Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yeah, trust God. Trust that God. You know, one thing what do you mean trust God? Jesus said, behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Listen to this, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. King David said the other day, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Listen to this, for thou art with me. You can say it like this. David said, yea, though I'm being crushed, I won't fear. Why? Because you're with me. In other words, I trust that you are with me. I trust you all the way through the crushing process, that there's a purpose and a point in it. And that purpose and point is to get the oil of life out of me, into my circumstances, into my situations, on my job, in my school, come on somebody, in my home, on my children, come on somebody. Yeah. So trust God. Number two, stay focused on the purpose. I understand the crushing process. The purpose behind it, you know, is to get that anointing oil out of me into my circumstances and situations. And right now, I need that oil. I need that yoke-breaking, burden-removing oil that's on the inside of me to be applied to some circumstances and situations right now in my life. I need it. So therefore, I'm not going to draw back from the crushing. Stay focused on the purpose. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you want to endure the crushing, listen to this. Stand your ground. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Don't run from the crushing. Oh, somebody, see, I told you your doppelganger wasn't going to like this, but your spirit is going, yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on. Stay grounded. Don't run from the crushing. Don't run from the process of it. People that are doing great things for God, they were the ones that have endured the crushing process. They have become now. They have become why they endured the crushing process. And we sit back and go, oh man, I love to have a ministry like that. Oh man, I love to be used like that. God, I love you. Work miracles to me and so forth and so on like that. Really? Really? Okay. You just need to go through the crushing process. You can do it. I mean, listen. I'm no respecter of person. If I do it for Jesse, I do it for you. If I do it for Jerry, I do it for you. If I do it for Copeland, I do it for you. If I did it for Hagen, I do it for you. If I did it for Moses, I do it for you. If I did it for Abraham, I do it for you. But all of them went through a crushing process. Thank you, Lord. I just heard the word of the Lord say, my ability to use you in any circumstance or situation depends on the amount of crushing you allow in your life. My ability to use you to a certain extent depends on how much you're willing to be crushed. Oh, think about that. See, the reason why some of us aren't any more usable than what he's using us to do, we may be doing a little something. We may be giving out a little tongue and interpretation here, but he want to use you to raise the dead. We may be giving a little a prophetic word here and a prophetic word there. Yeah, but he wanted you use you to heal the sick. He wanted to use you to win a nation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Go back and read about all of these great men of God of our day and see the crushing process they went through to get to where they are right now. Did you know Oral Roberts had to believe God for tuberculosis? Was that tuberculosis he was dying of? I think it was. Lester Summerall, he was another one that was dying, I think, of tuberculosis. He had to believe. Kenneth Hagin had to be. He was paralyzed, you know, and laid on a bed of affliction for over a year, I think, or close to a year. Thank you, Lord Jesus. They all went through crushing processes. The fact of the matter is, some people, in the midst of their crushing process, just let it take it completely out. They didn't want to be crushed, and they didn't want to endure the crushing process, so it took them completely out. Thank you, Lord Jesus. What God intended for just to crush you, to get the oil out of you, wind up killing you. I'm talking not you, but some people wind up killing them. God didn't intend for it to kill them. It was just to be a crushing. Okay, last one right here. If you want to make it through the crushing, not the last one. If you want to make it through the crushing, you got to stay focused on the word. When the devil really starts bearing down, you know what I do? I get to the word and start meditating. Well, I pull my scriptures out and I start going over those scriptures. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. He was wounded for my transgression, bruised for my iniquities. Even as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. And I'm just in there just meditating that word. And the pressure is continuing to come. I stay focused on the word. You got to stay, if you want to endure the crushing, you got to stay focused on the word. The word will give you strength. The word will build you up. The word will keep you strong. The word will keep you steady. Blessed is the man that walking out in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standing in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, or in his word, do he meditate day and night. Listen to this. And he shall be like a tree planted, immovable. So that when the crushing comes, the only thing that's going to be messed up is the will of this doppelganger right here. Last one right here. If you want to endure the crushing, you must pray through. No, I didn't say get through praying. I say you must pray through. Remember Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? He prayed through. Even in the midst of all of that crushing. And see, that's the thing. If you're in your Gethsemane right now, if you're in the oil press right now, and you're being pressed, my God, get on your knees and pray. And pray and pray and pray until you pray through. Until you pray through. Jesus evidently prayed through, because when he came to his disciples, he told them, sleep on now. All of that, and you can tell he was soaking wet with the oil of life, because when they came to take him, he said, whom are you looking for? They say, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am he. And the minute he said that, he was so soaking wet and saturated with the anointing of God, they all fell under the power. He said, I am he. And boy, they just fell like dominoes. He was saturated with it. If you want to make it through the crushing process, you got to stand your ground. You got to stay focused. You got to stay in the word. You got to stay, be sound. You got to stay focused on your purpose, and you got to pray through. You got to pray through. Don't get through praying, but pray through. You know, and that's the two things that I stay focused on. Number one, I stay focused on the word. And number two, I constantly pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Why? Because I'm not running from this crushing process. I realize that that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. But how do I get he that is in me into my circumstances and situations? There has to be a crushing. Oh, would to God that you and everyone that's listening to me would submit themselves to the crushing process so that they can become whatever it is God has for you, so that you can become. Right now, it does not yet appear what you shall be. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But if you go through the crushing process, we're all going to see what you are. If you go through the, if you submit yourself to the crushing process. I don't know about you. I mean, no. It's not fun at all. Your flesh going to be, help, let me up. It ain't fun at all. Thank you, Lord Jesus. But it's necessary. It's necessary. Because that outer man is going to fight you and God every step of the way. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Anything out there? Come on, stand. Glory to God. The crushing.